a beacon set on a hill. We aim to be a beacon of God's good news in Handsworth and wherever He places us to live and work. We are here to demonstrate to others the good news of Jesus Christ, to restore lives, rebuild community, and build up the body of the church in love, so that all are actively involved in the task. Go, be fruitful, and multiply.
Good morning, everyone. How is your morning? Yeah? Was you able to sleep through the night without sweating buckets or? Yeah, it felt like I'm in the Caribbean. That's not a bad thing. Yes, we're going to open today with Psalms 48. I want to welcome those that are joining us online. If you're joining us this morning or if you're doing that later, we want to welcome you. May you hear the word of the Lord today directly to you. So we're going to read Psalms 48. And you can follow in your Bibles. I'm going to read from the the New Living Translation. Psalms 48. How great is the Lord? How deserving of praise in the city of our God, which sits on His holy mountain. It is high and magnificent. The whole earth rejoices to see it. Mount Zion, the holy mountain, is a city of the great King. God Himself is in Jerusalem's towers, revealing Himself as its defender. The kings of the earth joined forces and advanced against the city. But when they saw it, they were stunned. They were terrified and ran away. They were gripped with terror and writhed in pain like a woman in labor. You destroyed them like a mighty ship of Tarshish, shattered by a powerful east wind. We had heard of the city's glory, but now we have seen it ourselves, the city of our Lord of heaven's armies. It is the city of our God. He will make it safe forever. O God, we meditate on your unfailing love as we worship in your temple. As your name deserves, O God, you will be praised to the ends of the earth. Your strong right hand is filled with victory. Let the people on Mount Zion rejoice. Let all the towns of Judah be glad because of your justice. Go inspect the city of Jerusalem. Walk around and count the many towers. Take note of the fortified walls and tour all the citadels, that you may describe them to future generations. For that is what God is like. He is our God forever and ever, and He will guide us until we die. Amen. Hallelujah. Praise God. My favorite verse is the God holds us with His strong right hand. That is such an encouragement this morning. I don't know what you might be feeling today. I hope that all is well with you. But if it's not, be encouraged this morning that God's got you. He's with you. He's with us. He will not leave us. He will not forsake us. We're going to hear a little bit later on from, you know, the word this morning about fellowshipping and the importance of us as, you know, people of God to fellowship with each other. May God's presence be with us this morning. I'm just going to ask Sister Eileen to come and pray for us, and then we're going to ask the worship team to come and lead us in songs, and we're going to worship together this morning. Amen? Amen. We're going to celebrate Jesus. Hallelujah.
Good morning, church. Good morning to those who are online as well. I'd just like to start by asking everyone, because hearing the word of God, hearing the prayer that Stacey prayed, let's all just get up and say, thank you, God, because he's brought us through another day. He's blessed us this morning. So let's give him the praise that he is truly worthy of. So, Lord, we thank you. Right, we bless your holy name. Thank you. All right, this morning, I opened my phone and someone sent me this. And when Stacey asked me to pray, I just thought, what's happening? God, are you with me this morning? It says, when I woke up this morning, I asked myself, what is life about? I found the answer in the room. The fan said, be cool. The roof said, aim higher. The window said, see the world. The clock said, every minute is precious. The mirror said, reflect before you act. The calendar said, be up to date. The door said, push hard and don't give up your goals. The floor said, kneel down and pray. So this morning I'm praying, I'm asking God to cover us with the blood of his son. Father, I thank you for getting us all here today in your house. Father, I give you all the thanks and all the praise, because without you, we are nothing. So, Father, this morning, let us bless and cover the one who's going to bring the word, that not only would it be helpful to us and feed us mentally, but also feed us spiritually, Lord, because that is what we are all doing this week. We're hearing all hard things, things that are not nice. But Father, we know that you've got the whole world in your hands. You've got us covered, oh Heavenly Father. And we give you thanks for that. We give you praise. We would always be there. You say you would never leave us or forsake us. So Father, this morning I'm holding you to that praise. I'm holding you to that word, oh Heavenly Father, that you have each and every one of us in your hands. So this morning, oh Father, in the name of your son, I give you all the praise. I give you all the glory in your precious name. Amen.
Amen. Thank you, worship team.
Good morning, church. It's glad to be back in the house. I've missed you. I've missed everyone, but I'm glad to be here to worship with you. We're here to give God the glory, give him the thanks, because he deserves it. Amen?
Amen.
If you're able to please stand, we're going to sing. We haven't got the lyrics, unfortunately. It doesn't seem to be working. But you know what? Regardless of what technology is doing or not doing today, we're still going to worship the Lord. The songs are very familiar. Amen. What a fellowship. What a joy divine. Leaning on the everlasting arms. Let's worship him. Hallelujah.
Praise God.
And as we sing the leaning bit, I want to see actually leaning. What a fellowship.
What a fellowship. What a joy divine. Leaning on the everlasting arms.
What a blessedness.
What a blessedness. What a peace is mine. Leaning on the everlasting arms. From all alarm, leaning
What a fellowship.
What a fellowship. What a joy divine. Leaning on the everlasting arm.
What a blessedness.
What a blessedness. What a peace is mine. Leaning on the everlasting arm.
Leaning.
Leaning. Leaning. Safe and secure from all alarm. Leaning. Leaning. Leaning on the everlasting
arm. What have I to dread?
Leaning on the everlasting arm. I have blessedness with my Lord so near. Leaning on the everlasting arm.
Leaning.
Leaning. Leaning.
Leaning.
Oh, yes. Safe and secure.
Everlasting arms of our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Because he's the arms that will never let us fall. He will never leave us. He will hold us, he'll protect us. You know, with things that have been going on in the community, in this country. But you know what? God is steadfast.
Amen.
God is loving. Amen. God is our protector. And he will continue to keep us and watch over us. Let's continue to worship him. The song says, blessed be your name. In the land that is plentiful, where your streams of abundance flow, blessed be your name. Let us worship him. Blessed be your name.
Blessed be your name in the land that is plentiful, where your streams of abundance flow. Blessed be your name.
Blessed be your name.
And blessed be your name when I'm found in the desert place, though I walk through the wilderness. blessed be your name.
Every blessing.
Every blessing you pour out, I'll turn back to praise. And when the darkness closes in, Lord, still I will say, blessed be the name of the Lord, blessed be your name. Blessed be the name of the Lord, blessed be your glorious name.
From the top.
Blessed be your name in the land that is plentiful.
Where your streams
of abundance flow. Blessed be your name.
And blessed be your name.
And blessed be your name. When I'm found in the desert place, though I walk through the wilderness, blessed be your name.
Every blessing you pour out.
And every blessing you pour out, I'll turn back to praise. And when the darkness closes in, Lord, still I will say, blessed be the name of the Lord, blessed be your name. Blessed be the name of the Lord, blessed be your glorious name. Blessed be the name of the Lord, blessed be your name.
When the Lord
thought that he should be, blessed be your name.
And blessed be your name.
And blessed be your name. On the road marked with suffering, where there's pain in the offering, blessed be your name.
Every blessing.
And every blessing you pour out, turn back to praise. Transformed and changed in his name.
Thank you, Jesus.
Amen. We're going to continue to worship him and give him the glory. One of the songs we're going to sing is one of my favorites. I've got many favorites, but this one, it's a beautiful song. The words are so beautiful because it speaks of who God is. Amen. It speaks of Christ and what he did for us. And we're going to worship him. The song says, how deep the Father's love for us, how vast beyond all measure, that he should give his only son to make a wretch his treasure. A wretch, us. How great the pain of searing loss, the Father turns his face away, has wounds which mar the chosen one, bring many sons to glory. You know, for many of us here with children, whether they are our own physical children or children that we've raised, you know, can you imagine having to turn your back on that child for them to face pain for others? That's what the Father did for us. He gave his only son. He turned his back on his only son so that his son could take on our sin. We're going to worship him and give him all the glory.
Amen.
How deep the Father's love for us, how vast beyond all measure, that he should give his only son
to make a wretch his treasure.
To make a wretch his treasure. How great the pain of searing love.
The Father turns his face away.
The Father turns his face away.
As wounds which mar the chosen one.
As wounds which mar the chosen one.
Bring many sons to glory.
Bring many sons to glory.
Let's go from the top again, how deep.
How deep the Father's love for us.
How vast beyond all measure.
How vast beyond all measure. That he should give his only son
to make a wretch his treasure.
To make him wretch his treasure.
How great the pain of searing loss.
How great the pain of searing loss.
The Father turns his face away.
The
chosen
as
one.
As wounds which mar the chosen one.
Bring many sons to glory.
Bring many sons to glory.
Behold.
Behold the man upon the
cross. My sin upon his shoulders.
My sin upon his shoulders.
Ashamed, I hear my mocking voice.
Ashamed, I hear my mocking
call
voice.
Call out among the scoffers.
Call out amongst the scoffers.
It was my sin that held him there.
It was my sin.
until it was accomplished.
Until it was accomplished.
His dying breath has brought me life.
His dying breath has brought me life.
I know that it is finished.
I know that it is finished.
I will not boast.
I will not boast in anything.
No gifts, no power, no wisdom.
No gifts, no power, no wisdom.
But I will boast in Jesus Christ.
But I will boast in Jesus.
His death and resurrection.
His death and resurrection.
Why should I gain from his reward?
Why should I gain from his reward?
I cannot give an answer.
I cannot give an answer.
But this I know with all my heart.
His wounds has paid my ransom.
I will not boast in anything.
I will not boast in anything.
No gifts, no power, no wisdom.
No gifts, no power, no wisdom.
But I will boast in Jesus Christ.
But I will boast. Why should I gain from his reward?
I cannot give an answer.
I cannot give an answer.
But this I know with all my heart.
But this I know with all my heart.
His wounds have paid my ransom.
His wounds has paid my ransom.
Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus.
Hallelujah.
Thank you, Almighty God.
Hallelujah.
Thank you for paying my ransom, Lord.
Hallelujah.
Oh God. Hallelujah.
You praise.
Jesus, for giving your son, Jesus Christ. Thank you, Almighty God, for paying the ransom that we could not pay. We could never repay.
That's right.
Thank you, Lord God. Hallelujah.
Thank you, Lord.
Praise your name.
We're going to take our offering.
Lord, we just want to thank you. We want to thank you for the reminder that your love for us is deep and it goes beyond every measure. Lord, as we offer our gifts to you, our monies, Lord, we pray that you will bless it, that you will breathe upon it, that it will go to further your kingdom. In Jesus' name. As we continue to contemplate on the depth of Jesus' love for us, we're going to do a communion.
Could we have our communion service up, please? Come and join me as we come around the table. That would be good. Thank you. As a teenager, you know, in my early teens at secondary school, I remember looking up at the sky. I went to a school that had a lot of area of countryside around it because you're on the edge of town. And I remember looking up to see an aeroplane passing by. Might seem like a simple thing, but for once in my life, I could realize just how much air, how much distance there was between me and that aeroplane. And I remember that so, that memory so clearly, thinking, wow, that's such a huge space of air between me and that plane all the way up there. And it made me think about how great God was. How, you know, this little thing is just so huge. He is so much greater. He made the universe. And at night, we would look up at the stars. I had a best friend who was also shared the same thoughts with me, that looking up and seeing those stars and realizing how far away they were and how they were just a small part of this massive universe that God had made, that he was greater than all these things because he made it. And it was funny, really, because I hadn't realized that my best friend also thought this until we started cycling home in the night after school and looking up at the stars and happened to comment on it. And eventually, talking about God and how great he was, I realized that my friend really did believe that God was there somewhere, that God, this God was so great, so huge. But what was difficult for him was to understand how you could possibly know a God like that. He was so distant, so great, so huge, so awesome. How could you know him? And I think for a lot of people, that's how they feel. They feel there's something out there. There has to be something behind all this amazing creation that we see that we cannot get our heads around. But for so many, I think God remains distant and untouchable, unreachable, because the universe is such a big place and we can't get our heads around him and we can't really understand what it's all about. He kind of pronounces his word, and yet he's too far away and too distant for us to really get to grips with. But as Christians, we've got this amazing news, and we mustn't forget and we mustn't wander away from him. This amazing good news that God himself became one of us in order to overcome that distance, in order to overcome that difficulty that we have, in order to overcome something else as well, which is the distance that we put between ourselves and him by being disobedient to his ways, by choosing to do our own thing, by just turning our eyes away from him and turning our back on him so we can't see him anymore. He came to bridge that gap. He came to show us what God was like. The Bible says that he, the word of God, became flesh and dwelt amongst us, lived among us. And that's Jesus, isn't it? And that's what people, when they were listening to Jesus, then they were talking with him, when they maybe if they could touch him, they could smell him, they could understand him, they could see what he was like, began to realize, his disciples began to realize through that time that they knew him, that here they were seeing what God was like. They were seeing God's character. They were seeing the wonderful love of God and the power of God in action, the wonderful concern of God for his people and for every person on planet Earth. Emmanuel, God with us, somebody that people could hear and see and touch and smell. One-to-one, so know what God is like. And when we read these words about the Last Supper and we read about Jesus and his disciples sat or reclined, as they would have done, as was their fashion in that time, at the table, taking the bread and wine, eating a meal together, it's such a human thing, isn't it? It's such a visceral thing, something you can take hold of and touch and see and understand, to sit down and to eat with one another, to talk, to be together, to share in a meal. And so when we have this time to eat and to drink the bread and the wine, Jesus had asked us to do this to remember him in person. And we need to remember that this is about relationship, that the good news is about relationship with one another and relationship with God. Jesus died on the cross so that he could bring heaven and earth together, but also so he could bring us together. And I love that picture of the cross. It's both directions, isn't it? He reconciled human beings to one another, made a way, but he reconciled us to God and broke that barrier, made that division nothing. And that's what this is all about, because it wasn't just a meal, but it was a time of Passover, when they were having a Passover meal, remembering God's deliverance in the past for his people, but Jesus giving it new meaning. That now for us, we must remember this, because the bread reminds us of Jesus' body broken so that we could be made whole, so that we could be made one with God, so that we could be forgiven. And it reminds us of his body, it's his blood poured out for us so that we could be washed clean. A sacrifice that prevents the judgment of God falling on us. Just as the blood of the Lamb was painted on the door all those years before, when the people of Israel were rescued from Egypt and the angel of death passed over their homes and they were free to go. So Jesus said, well, it says here, that when the hour came, he reclined at table with the apostles with him, and he said to them, I have earnestly desired. I really wanted to eat this Passover with you before I suffer. For I tell you, I will not eat it until it is fulfilled in the kingdom of God. I'm not going to do this again until what I've come to do has been completed. And he took a cup, and when he'd given thanks, he said, take this, divide it among yourselves, for I tell you that from now on I will not drink of the fruit of the vine until the kingdom of God comes. There were many cups in Passover, but then we come to the two things, the cup and the bread that gives meaning to, a new meaning to Passover. He took the bread, which, and when he'd given thanks, he broke it and gave it to them, saying, this is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. And likewise, the cup after they'd eaten, saying, this cup is that is poured out for you is the new covenant in my blood. In my blood. This is God in the flesh, in person, coming to us and saying, I made a way for you to know me. I'm going to make a way. This is what Jesus said to his disciples. And for all of us who believe, as we come, let's do this remembering that he came to give us that relationship, that one-to-one relationship with him, with God again, so that we needn't live feeling like God is far, far, far away and we can never, never meet him, because Jesus himself came in the flesh, his body broken for us, his blood poured out for us, that we could be forgiven, that we could be included in his kingdom, in his family, that we could know him day by day and live with him. Let's just give thanks. Let's be quiet for a moment. The quietness of your own heart. Maybe, I don't know, the Lord knows what he's put on your heart this morning. Maybe there's something you need to say to him, to say, sorry, Lord, I'm so sorry. I know that I haven't thought, I haven't spoken, I haven't behaved in the way that I should to glorify you. I know that I never meet up to that standard. And I just come before you this morning humbly for your forgiveness. Or maybe, Lord, I know that maybe this past week, maybe a past time in my life now has been for ages that I've not felt that you're close. But you seem so far away from me. But I need you. And I need to be close to you again. Lord, will you come? As I remember your death on the cross, I remember your blood poured out for me, your body just broken, hanging there on the cross for me in my place. And I know that it's done and it's finished and it's over with and my sin is dealt with and that I don't need to feel far away with you anymore. Just wash away all the confusion. Just as your word says that you will wash, that you will cleanse, that you will make us clean and new again. So Lord, will you open our eyes to see you again? Open my eyes to see you and know that you are with me day by day, because your body was broken for me, your blood poured out for me, and that sacrifice still stands today. Thank you. So, Lord, as we take the bread, we thank you for this bread. Thank you that it symbolizes something so real, something as we can touch this morning. So you came in a body to give that body up, that life up for us. Thank you for your body broken. And all we have in return is our broken lives. We give back to you this morning. I ask that as we eat, you would refresh, that you would renew, that you would redeem, that you would restore, that you would help us to grasp again the depth of your love and to know that you can use these weak old bodies. You can use them for your purpose, that you have, are able to place your glory in us, your spirit, so that we can show others what you're like too. Help us to see that in the physical, the physicality, the physicalness of bread as we take it and as we eat it together, I pray. In Jesus' name, amen. All we usually say, and I'll say again this morning, if you're a believer this morning, you're invited to take the bread as it comes around and eat it as you receive it. If you know for some reason you're still holding out against him, well, there are things in your life that you know have to be sorted out that you just can't quite deal with. You need to deal with them. Deal with them this morning. Deal with them this week, and then maybe come back and take communion when we take it again. But don't just take it glibly as if it's, well, it's coming round, I'll just take it. But remember that we're remembering the body of Jesus broken, our Saviour, the chosen one, the perfect one. Please do pass the bread around. The body of Jesus was broken to make us whole. So we take this bread and we eat it together. As we receive it, let's eat. As we feel that bread in our hands, let's remember the body of Jesus was broken for you, for me. Receive his love this morning. Receive his forgiveness. Receive his redemption. So we're going to pass the cups around, and with the cups, if you just hold on to them until we come, we all have a cup and we can all come together to drink together as one. Lord Jesus, we believe you're here now with us. You promised that you would be. So, Lord, we come humbly to say thank you. Thank you for making us one body together with the same life, the life that you poured out when you gave your blood, you gave your lifeblood on the cross. Thank you. Lord, will you help us, revive us, we pray, as we drink, help us to realize again that you are pouring your spirit into us day by day if we're ready to receive, that you have made us clean, that you have paid the price, that we are your ambassadors to the world. Lord, we want to give our life for your kingdom, our life that this world may be changed, that your kingdom may come, that your will be done here on earth as it is in heaven. Amen. Let's drink together. Thank you. I'm going to hand back over to Stacey as we collect the cups.
So for the children that are here, that are primary age children, there are some colouring papers and pens at the back. If you want to utilise that and stay close to your parents, that's okay. We're going to invite Chris to come and give the word. I'm just going to pray for you. Lord, we just want to thank you for your servant. We pray, God, that every word that comes from his mouth will be that which proceeds from your mouth this morning. We ask that you will bless us in Jesus' name. Amen.
Okay. So it's a nice day, so I'm not going to be a long time because I'm sure you want to enjoy the sunshine. Actually, Tim talking about aeroplanes earlier reminded me of the other week when we went to Cape Verde. It was an eye-opener. All-inclusive, but I didn't realise I would be the food and the mosquitoes were the guests. I didn't like to go out of my hotel room. I started wearing long trousers looking for the notice. And you don't even notice them. You don't know until they've been on you and bitten you. And it itches, and that's the worst thing. Horrible, horrible. But it was a nice holiday. It was an eye-opener, but it was a nice holiday. So today I'm going to look at 1 John. And 1 John is basically 5 chapters. And I'm going to look at chapter 1 and 2. Chapter 1 is not a very long chapter, and 2 isn't really massive. So chapter 1 and 2 talk about fellowship, the tests of fellowship. Chapters 3 to 5 talk about sonship, because there's a big difference between fellowship and sonship. So fellowship and sonship are two distinct aspects of our relationship with God, each revealing different dimensions of his love and grace towards us. I'm going to read the text in a minute, but I'll just give you an idea of the difference. Fellowship is characterized by our walking in the light, walking in light or darkness, reflecting the state of our current relationship with God. In 1 John, in chapter 1, 5 to 7, we are reminded that God is light, and in him there is no darkness. So it's a matter of light and darkness. It's not a matter of your salvation. Sometimes we can fall out of fellowship with God, but we're still his children. It's like your kids aren't always obedient to you, but they're still your kids. The relationship might be disturbed a little bit if they're naughty, if they don't do what you say, but they're still your children. So sonship is a matter of life and death. If you're not a son of God, you're not saved. People can pretend to have fellowship with God, but they can fall out of fellowship with God. But God accepts us even though we're not acceptable. He accepts us even though we're not acceptable. That's just how it is, because fellowship requires our work, our obedience, as well as God. It's a two-way thing. Sonship is entirely God's work. It's finished at the cross. Sonship was taken care of by Jesus Christ at Calvary. It's nothing to do with us. If we could do something to fall out of sonship with God, that would mean we'd have to do something to keep it. Therefore, it wouldn't be all Christ's work, would it? But the aim is that we should be obedient. We should be obedient. So what gets in the way of our fellowship? Well, obviously, the world. Does anyone know what the difference between a lunar eclipse and a solar eclipse? Serena, you should know, you're a teacher. You don't know. Well, a lunar eclipse is when the Earth gets between the sun and the moon, because the moon doesn't have any light on its own. It just reflects the light of the sun. So when the sun's at the other side of the world, it's nighttime here. The moon's so high up, the sun's still reflecting on the moon. So the light we see on the moon is a reflection of the sun's light. But when it's a lunar eclipse, they're lined up. So the sun's there, the Earth's in the middle, then you've got the moon. So the world is blocking the light of the sun. As with fellowship, from time to time, the world gets in the way. We are supposed to reflect the light of the Son of God. But when we get too involved in the world, that light is blocked. Temporarily, it can be blocked, and it happens to all of us from time to time. Okay, let's get on. I'm going to read the chapter now, the two chapters now. That which was from the beginning, which we have heard, which we may have seen, which we have seen with our eyes, which we have looked upon with our hands and handled of the word of life. For the life was manifested, and we have seen it, and bear witness, and show unto you that eternal life, which was with the Father, and was manifested unto us. That which we have seen and heard, declare we unto you, that ye also may have fellowship with us. And truly our fellowship is with the Father, and with his Son, Jesus Christ. And these things write we unto you, that your joy may be full. Then this is the message which we have heard of him and declare unto you, that God is light, and in him is no darkness at all. If we say that we have fellowship with him, we walk in darkness, we lie and do not have truth. But if we walk in light and he is in the light, we have fellowship with one another, and the blood of Jesus Christ, his son, cleanses us from all sin. If we say that we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. If we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. If we say that we have not sinned, we make him a liar, and his word is not in us. So from time to time, we are going to sin. We are going to sin. And if we say we don't sin, we're lying. We are lying. Even Paul himself in Romans 7, I've quoted this many times, I think just most people who've preached here have, that it talks about the things that you want to do, the good things you know you should do, but you don't. And you do the things you know you shouldn't. So if someone like Paul's going to do that, come on, we can't say that we don't sin without lying. Chapter 2. My little children, these things write I unto you, that ye sin not. And if any man sin, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ, the righteous. And he is the propitiation for our sins, and not for ours only, but also for the sins of the whole world. And hereby we do know that we know him, if we keep his commandments. He that saith, I know him, and keepeth not his commandments, is a liar, and the truth is not in him. But whoso keepeth his word in him, verily is the love of God perfected. Hereby now we are in him. He that saith he abideth in him ought himself also so to walk, even as he walked. We can't walk as Jesus walked, obviously, but we try. The Holy Spirit helps us every single day, but we are still sinners. The difference is, before we came to Christ, we were sinners running to sin. Now we're sinners running away from sin. Sometimes it catches up with us, sometimes it doesn't. It depends on how obedient we are. But being fleshly individuals, we're not always obedient. But whoso keepeth his word in him, verily is the love of God perfected, hereby now that we are with him. He that saith abideth in him ought himself also so to walk even as he walked. Brethren, I write no new commandment unto you, but an old commandment which ye had from the beginning. The old commandment is the word which you have heard from the beginning. Again, a new commandment I write to you, which thing is true in him and in you, because the darkness is past, and the true light now shineth. He that saith he is in the light, and hateth his brother, is in darkness until now. He that loveth his brother abideth in the light, and there is none occasion of stumbling in him. But he that hateth his brother is in darkness, and walketh in darkness, and knoweth not whither he goeth, because that darkness has blinded his eyes. I write unto you, little children, because your sins are forgiven you for his name's sake. I write unto you, fathers, because you have known him that is from the beginning. I write unto you, young men, because you have overcome the wicked one. I write unto you, little children, because you have known the Father. I have written unto you, fathers, because you have known him that is from the beginning. I have written unto you, young men, because ye are strong, and the word of God abideth in you, and ye have overcome the wicked one. Love not the world, neither the things that are in the world. Bible paper. When it says love not the world, it doesn't mean you've got to hate the world. John 3:16 says, God so loved the world. It's not you've got to hate the flowers and oceans and the beautiful things that we need to live and food. It's the worldly systems that Satan's put in place. That's what it means when he says, not part of the world. If any man love the world, the love of the Father is not in him. For all that is in the world, the lust of the flesh and the lust of the eyes and the pride of life is not of the Father, but is of the world. And the world passeth away, and the lust thereof, but he that doeth the will of God abideth forever. Little children, it is the last time, and as you have heard that Antichrist shall come, even now there are many Antichrists, whereby we know that it is the last time. They went out from us, but they were not of us. For if they had been of us, they would no doubt have continued with us. That's saying about the sonship. If you're a true son of God, you'll never fall away. God finishes a work he starts. We get many people who profess to be Christians, but eventually they're going to show the true colours and fall away. That's why it says here, if they'd been one of us, they would have never gone away, but they would have stayed. They were not one of us, but you have an unction from the Holy One, and you know all things. I have not written unto you because you know not the truth, but because you know it, and that no lie is is of the truth. Where is a liar but he that denieth that Jesus is the Christ? He is Antichrist that denieth the Father and the Son. Whosoever denieth the Son, the same have not the Father, but he that acknowledgeth the Son have the Father also. Let that therefore abide in you, which you have heard from the beginning. It's longer than I thought. If that which ye have heard from the beginning shall remain in you, ye also shall continue in the Son and in the Father. And this is the promise that he have promised us, even eternal life. These things I have written unto you concerning them that seduce you. But the anointing which ye have received of him abideth in you. And ye need not that any man teach you, but as the same anointing teacheth you of all things and its truth, and is no lie. And even as it hath taught you, ye shall abide in him. And now, little children, abide in him, that when he shall appear, we may have confidence and not be ashamed before him at his coming. If you know that he is righteous, you know that everyone that doeth righteousness is born of him. So Paul's responding here sometimes to these Gnostics that's come into the church. They're always coming into the church. And basically, one of the things they believe, that all flesh was evil. All flesh, anything material was evil, and only spiritual things could be good. And that Jesus only came as an image of a man. He didn't come as real flesh. And Paul's saying here, he says, back into the last page again, is saying to from the beginning, which we have looked upon with our hands and handled of the word of life. Paul's not saying, I'm not going to come up with a counter argument to these people. I'm not giving some theological argument. I'm telling you what I saw and what I felt. Jesus is real. Because without a real Jesus, there's no real salvation. Jesus needed to be a man. And these Gnostics thought they had some special knowledge, some superior knowledge. They troubled Paul, they troubled all the apostles. They were one of the biggest troubles in the church, them and the Judaizers. Anyway, so as I believe it's essential to recognize the difference between fellowship and sonship, while understanding the unconditional love and grace that God extends towards us. While fellowship may fluctuate based on our circumstances, sonship remains steadfast, because that is all Christ's work. It wouldn't be steadfast if we had something to do with it, I can guarantee you that. So basically, there's three tests of fellowship. And the first test is the test of obedience. In 1 John 3, in chapter 2, verses 3 to 6, we were reminded that true fellowship with God is evidenced by our obedience to him, to his commandments. Obedience is not merely following a set of rules. It's not just following a set of rules, but a reflection of our love for God and our desire to walk in his ways. You know, just as a tree bears fruit, you can see our obedience reveals the condition of our hearts. The condition of fruit on a tree, whether a tree is barren, shows the condition of the tree. So the more we obedient we are, the more that reflects Christ in us, and more people can see that. Sin can distort that. Similarly, our obedience demonstrates that our spiritual health and the depth of our relationship with God. As I say, fellowship is, if you fall out of fellowship with God from time to time, it doesn't mean you've lost your salvation. Sometimes you might not feel saved, but you're not saved by how you feel. You're saved by the blood of Jesus Christ. So we must examine ourselves, our lives regularly to see if our actions align with God's word. When faced with decisions, we need to seek to obey him. Let our obedience be testimony to our faith and a source of blessings for others. We cannot really go around in the world saying one thing in church and then doing a different thing. What kind of a message would that give to people? So we need to be obedient. We need to, reflect God in us. As the moon reflects the sun, we should reflect Jesus Christ in our lives. So like James chapter 1, verse 22 to 25 urges us not to be hearers only, but doers of the word, illustrating that true obedience involves putting God's teaching into practice. So it's not just saying, but doing. Christianity is an active religion. I think I spoke about it before a good while ago. But it's about involvement. It's about doing unto others as you would have them do unto you. And that reflects Christ in you. And then hopefully that they will come to know Christ as well. It's more than just going out and spreading the gospel. You can spread the gospel with your lifestyle. I remember once, it was a Bible study here, and I think it was Rachel Dehaney says, it's not just a witness in word or with a study. The witness is also in your life, the way you live, setting a good example. Unlike certain politicians, I'm not going to name any politicians because we don't, but they might, for example, come on TV saying, you must not do that, have gatherings, and then what do? They have big parties, you know. So what do you think of that MP then? What is your opinion of them? You know, so if we do that, if we're saying Jesus is this and Jesus is that, and then they see us doing something completely different, does that really reflect Christ? That's going to give more of a bad example, isn't it? Really bad example. So the next test is love. In 1 John chapter 3, 1 John chapter 3, 14 to 18, emphasizes the importance of love in our relationship with God and others. Genuine love is selfless, sacrificial, extends beyond mere words to tangible actions, and reflect God's love for us. As most of it seems to be about actions all the time. But what is fellowship? What is actual fellowship? Do we think of just the people in our church? You know, when I went to Cape Verde, we went on this tour one day, and apparently a lot of the country is Catholic. So probably about 70, 75%, I think he said. Was it about 75%, Serena? Yeah. But the rest are Christians from different kinds of denominations, and there's probably a very small percentage of Muslims, but they're usually immigrants, they're not native Cape Verdeans. And what I noticed, this goes with showing love for your fellow brothers and sisters in Christ. Until you see poverty with your own eyes, you don't realize what an effect it has on you. You can see it on the news. You can see people living in these shanty towns. But you just say, oh dear, what a shame, and then carry on eating your dinner. Unless you see it yourself. And when we was out, we saw this shantytown, and the houses were like tarpaulins and rusty corrugated metal and old pallets put together. And you think, people are living in them. People are living in them houses. And these are supposed to be Christians. Yet there's Christians in the world, in the West, who are quite wealthy. We have a completely different attitude over here to what they have. Because we live in a rich country. We really do live in a rich country. Yet we see people. I know Serena's always telling me I'm too harsh on these beggars. You know, they're not disabled. They could get a job. But I know I can be harsh. And I know that. And I've been homeless since then, you know. And that was out of my circumstances. So I know where they're coming from. For a short time in London, I ended up having a flat and getting evicted because I was paying my rent, but the person I was paying the rent to, it wasn't their place. I got the advertisement out at London Standard. It was a council house, and they weren't bothering to pay the rent, and I was paying them, and then I didn't know until the bailiffs come round. So I ended up sleeping on buses for a couple of months. So I do know it can be out of your circumstances. But the thing is, it's how you pick yourself up again. Because all the time I was homeless, I was still working, you know. But it's how you respond to those circumstances. And a lot of people in England, they go through these bad circumstances and then they fall into mental health. And a lot of that mental health, some of it can be through normal things, but a lot of it's due to alcohol and drugs. They turn to alcohol and drugs rather than try and find a way out. And what I mentioned it to Serena when we came back, I says, you know the difference with Cape Verde? These people live in extreme poverty. But we've walked around the main city, we've walked everywhere, and not one person has begged for money or begged for anything. And they're all happy. all happy, they're smiley, friendly people. And the tour guide was telling us they only go to church Christmas Day and Easter because they're too busy working. The people who live in these shanty towns have absolutely nothing, will make things, make bracelets out of shells and sell them rather than beg. And if they have a bit of rain, the people go up to the mountains and they grow enough vegetables just for their family. Could you imagine people in England doing that? In our spoiled society, where we expect handouts, where we concentrate on our wants rather than our needs. We take our needs for granted. And then we feel like we're in poverty because we haven't got the latest iPhone or our smart screen TV as big as next door's. You know, if we took care of our needs, then took care of the needs of other Christians around the world, and then took care of our wants, that would make a big dent in poverty within Christian communities around the world. It really would. And when you see the integrity of these people, they have a completely different view on life, and that is true fellowship. In fact, I didn't see this myself, but I looked into it before we went, that if you walk down the road eating food, people just come and take some food. And it's just normal. They just share. And they don't even think nothing about it. In Cape Verde, they just come up and they just share. It's slightly different from mainland African community because it is an ex-slave island. It was an uninhabited island and then the Portuguese brought slaves there. So it's got European and African influence. It's very much like Caribbean style influence or Brazil, you know, that kind of influence. But there's a sense of fellowship and community and looking after each other because they don't get no help from the government. There's no roads to say except for around the hotels. It almost makes you feel guilty when you're in the hotel and you've got all this all-you-can-eat buffet when it's not me and the mosquitoes, you're eating the food. And the people serving you think, when they finish their shift, and it's long shifts, where do they? What kind of a house do they go back to? You know, because most of the nice houses are probably owned by Europeans or on holiday there, as holiday homes. And so there's either social housing or shanty towns. But spiritually, they are wealthy. Spiritually, we are in poverty. We think about our own needs and the needs of our small circle. That's not true fellowship. Fellowship should be brought throughout all the Christian community, throughout all the world. And until you see that with your own eyes, I was surprised. You see it on the telly, but it just doesn't sink in. I mean, Sabine was shocked when she saw a school in the shanty town. It was like a big shed falling to bits with school spray painted on the side. And they don't have money to buy books and things. And just a few books can go a long way, you know. That's true fellowship. And this is a test of love. Do we really love our brothers and sisters? Christ often mentions this. We need to not just help those who can give us back. I'll lend him a tenner because I know if I want a tenner, I'll get one back one day. You should lend money to those who can never pay you back. You know they can't pay you back. That's true love. That's true fellowship. You know, Cape Verde is actually a wonderful country. But and I'll tell you just, this has nothing to do, I'm going to tell you this now. So one thing that I'd never seen before, and probably never see again, is there's no roads, basically. And we were going through this deserty area. I don't know if it's a desert or not, but it was just flat for miles and miles. And in the distance was a massive lake glistening in the sun. Big, big lake. And we all got out of the bus taking photos. And the bus driver says, the guide said, it's not a lake. If you walk towards it, it'll disappear. It's a mirage. So it did look like a big lake, didn't it, Sabine? We took some photos. You can see it on the photos, in fact. And if you walk towards it, it disappears and appears behind you. I've never seen anything like that. But unlike a mirage, Christ is real, obviously. But it is an amazing thing to see. And I don't know how it happens. You see him on the cartoons on telly where they run up and they're drinking water and it's suddenly putting sand in the mouth. It's not like that at all. But it is a big lake with trees around it, and that. It's a very unusual thing to see. Very unusual thing to see. I better get on with this now. So that's the second test. I'm going to cut this short and go to the last test now, if I can find it. Okay, the truth test or the identity test. So, 1 John chapter... Am I reading my chapter 3, verse 10? First John chapter 3, verses 9 and 10 reveal that our identity as children of God is manifested in our righteous living and our rejection of sinful practices. Our actions should reflect the nature of God and testify the transformative work of the Holy Spirit in our lives. So if you think of a caterpillar when it transforms to a butterfly, it goes from one complete thing to another, shedding its old self and embracing a new life. And a new life in Christ reflects that, but of righteousness and holiness. He's given us his Spirit to help us. We are always at war with the flesh. We're always going to be at war with our old self, because I think I might have said it a few weeks ago, but Christ conquered the penalty of sin at the cross, but he didn't conquer the presence of sin. That will always be with us until we die or Christ returns, but he's conquered the penalty of sin. Christians haven't really, we don't need to keep asking for forgiveness for our sins, because our sins were forgiven at Calvary. Our sins were forgiven at Calvary. And some people might say, well, in the Lord's Prayer, it teaches us to ask for forgiveness. And yet we do acknowledge our forgiveness, and we need to thank him for that forgiveness, but we don't need to keep asking for forgiveness. If you think about the Lord's Prayer, who was that written to? It was written to Jews, and the timing, it was written before the crucifixion. Because if you take the Lord's Prayer as applied to us, you can only go up to about verse 10. Otherwise, your forgiveness is dependent on you forgiving others, which it isn't. Our forgiveness is only dependent on Jesus Christ and his work at the cross. So that is the difference between fellowship and sonship. As I say, fellowship is a matter of light and darkness. Sonship is a matter of life and death. It says, it says something somewhere anyway, I know that. But we just need to believe. And if you are a true believer, you will not backslide. If you backslide, you've never really believed. You can go through the motions. You can play church games. You can do all that kind of thing. But a true believer will never, he might fall out of fellowship with God from time to time. A child falls out of fellowship with his parents from time to time, sometimes for quite a long time. But you are always a child of God. You always will be a child of God. And that's what the importance of sonship is, and the importance of fellowship, which helps us along. So our fellowship is not an identifier of our salvation. Because people can pretend, people can play at church, they can say hallelujah, they can give money to charity, they can do all sorts of things. They can work on the door, do all different things for years, and next thing they're back in the world again. Why? Because it was never part of the church in the first place. It was never in their heart. If you are a true believer, you will never slip away. Never slip away. So true fellowship. What is true fellowship? If we reflect on these three tests, it's mainly about watching out for others. It's about bearing good fruit. That shows the health. You can pretend to bear good fruit. I mean, you can bite an apple and it's got wasp in it. You know what I mean? You don't know. You don't know until you bite it. But it's that continuation. You've got to always try. You will slip up now and again. You will, because you're human. You're human, you will slip. But Christ will pick you up. You can get distracted by the world. We're still tied to the world. We've still got this fleshly body with us. But what did Christ do with Peter? Peter got out of the boat. He walked to Christ, and he got distracted by the waves and all this environment around him. But what did Christ do? He lifted him back up. Lifted him back up. But the thing is, at least he got out of the boat and walked. At least he got out of the boat. Not like the rest of them. They had a bit of a praise and worship time in the safety of the boat. But Peter went on the water. There's too many people praising from the boat. You can't praise from the boat. You can't praise and have true fellowship just within the church. We need to look broader than that. We need to look to the broader Christian community. And not just Christian community. We can reflect that love in other communities as well to show the love of Christ. And I'm going to cut it at that. So thank you.
Thank you, Chris. Thank you for the reminder that we are sons of God. And that's not just about male. It's inclusive of male and female. If you felt like you're not a son of God, a child of God, before you heard this word, I pray that you're encouraged and reminded and you take hold of that there's nothing you and I could do to gain or to, as children, sometimes if you did all the things that's right, then you might have the praise of your parents going, oh, well done for doing that. With God, it's so much different. His love goes far beyond what we could do, whether we extend our hands to those that are in need or not, his love goes far beyond that. Please be reminded of that, that there's nothing we can do to gain that reward that Christ has died for us. God loves us. Do you feel unloved this morning? Are the pressures of life getting you down and it's challenging you not to feel God's love? Because often we're human beings, and often when difficult things happen to us or when we experience different difficult situations, we tend to measure God's love for us. We tend to measure whether God's with us. We tend to measure, oh, are we good enough? You are good enough by the blood of Jesus. Not by any works, but by the blood of Jesus. Father God, I just want to thank you. I want to thank you for your word that goes far beyond what I could think, what I could imagine, what I and your people could do. I want to thank you, God, that you love us beyond all measure, beyond all our standards and our ways of doing things and the ways we choose to live or not to live, Father God. I want to thank you that your arms are open, extended to us continually, God. Until you say when, your arms are extended to us. I pray that those amongst us, oh God, those that might join later online or whenever they see this message or this service, oh God, that they will know the truth that you love them, that your arms are open. We pray, God, for those that are less fortunate. We pray that, God, you will extend your kingdom through us. Use us to extend your kingdom to serve those that are in need, oh God. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Okay. Praise God. We're going to have our notices.
Good afternoon, Beacon, and welcome to everyone online and in the building. We'd also like to welcome Tenby, Duna, and Musa, all the way from South Africa, who are staying with Ricky and Dion. Welcome to Beacon. Just give us a wave so people know who you are. Amen. Welcome. Okay, I'd like to remind everyone that we have the Beacon Summer Cleanup, and that will be on Tuesday, the 20th of August, between 3 and 7 p.m. So if you can help, please come. If you can't do the full duration, can you do some hours? And I just want to see a show of hands who may be available to attend so that, you know, as soon as Veronica comes back, we can let her know. So just a show of hands. Okay, amen, amen. I'm going to ask Fran if you can just note down who's put their hands up. And for anyone who can come, whether it's an hour, please come and join, because we do need to give the furnishing a soft furnishing, and that's between 3 and 7 p.m. on Tuesday. And also, if you have a vacuum cleaner that can help with soft furnishing, if you can let Fran know as well, so we've got as much information to give Veronica when she returns. And all the August birthdays, happy birthdays to you all. I hope you're having a wonderful day when it comes. Also, Beacon will be having a Caribbean brunch on Saturday, the 14th of September, and that will be, what time does that start again? Yeah, 2 till 6 p.m. And Marie has the tickets, so if you can get your tickets, and if you can invite somebody as well, that would be nice. There's not much tickets left, so hurry up. And also, Hyacinth has raffle tickets. There's 2 free tickets going. It's £1 a strip, so get your strips, pay your pound, and you never know, you might win the ticket. God is good. Also, yes? The Caribbean ticket, Caribbean brunch tickets are £7, and that includes children as then. It's an overall cost. All funds will be going to the Beacon Project. I just want to say that we have some news from Brother Jones, if Pastor Tim can come up.
I just asked to share with you and ask for your prayers, please, from Brother Jones's family. It appears that he had a stroke of some kind on Friday at some point, and he's at the moment in City Hospital, but he's going to be moved to Sandwell, to the stroke unit there. So please, can we pray now for him and for the rest of his family? And if you remember him, and if I get any more details, I'll let you know. But let's pray. Ah, Lord Jesus, thank you that you see right into Ken's heart and mind. You see into his body and what's happened to him in this time. And we know that you are able to just lay your hand on him and give him peace right at this time, right at this moment. Lord, you are the one who can heal. So will you come and heal? Will you come and restore? Will you come and give him back the sense of being able to control his body or whatever he needs, Lord, to be restored? Will you come? And will you come into his family with your peace and your courage, that you would just overwhelm them with a sense that you are with them and that you are with him and that you are walking alongside of them? Will you just lift them up? Bear them up in this time. And we pray especially for Mrs. Jones, for Mavis, that, Lord, you would keep her calm, that the peace of God that passes all understanding will cover and fill her and keep hold of her, your peace at this time, and that you would bring the family closer together around this situation. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you. Please carry on praying. There are other people to pray for as well. You know who they are. And if over the summer you haven't seen somebody here, maybe get in touch. They might have been away on holiday, but they might not. They might not have been well. So get in touch with somebody if the Holy Spirit brings them to mind, and encourage them. And enjoy the rest of this day, which I think is probably going to get warmer as we go through it. Thank you.